Good morning, brothers and sisters. Today I want to talk about this treasure that we have in earthen vessels. Our passage of scripture today is in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 from verse 7 through 18. And the word of God reads, "But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, so that the surpassing greatness of the power will be of God and not from ourselves. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not despairing, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying about in the body the dying of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. For we who live are constantly being delivered over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus also may be manifest in our mortal flesh. So death works in us, but life in you. But having the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, 'I believe, therefore I spoke,' we also believe, therefore we also speak, knowing that he who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus, and will present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, so that the grace which is spreading to more and more people may cause the giving of thanks to abound to the glory of God. Therefore we do not lose heart, but though our outer man is decaying, yet our inner man is being renewed day by day. For momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory far beyond all comparison, while we look not at the things which are seen, but the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal." In the marvelous passage of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, Paul describes the true Christian life as one of weakness and suffering, and he explains the reason why this is so. He is reproving the false teachers as well as instructing the saints. The false teachers apparently criticized Paul for his suffering lifestyle. They sought the easy path. They were more oriented to the prosperity gospel. In contrast, Paul, they were full, rich, reigning, strong, honorable, or at least thought themselves so. This is the teaching of the Kingdom Now theology. They believe they are already reigning. They promise kingdom miracles, healing, and riches. Paul corrects this thinking. Now we have this treasure. This is the salvation that is described in verse 6. It is the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. It is regeneration, forgiveness of sins, justification, eternal life, adoption, all spiritual blessing in Christ, a royal priesthood, and joint heirs with Christ. We have treasures indeed. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. The earthen vessel is the natural body. Though we are now the sons of God, in this present world we are not manifest as the sons of God. For the earnest expectation of the creature waits for the manifestations of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who had subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also should be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans and travails in pain together until now. And not only they, but we ourselves, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body. In the natural body, we are subject to vanity, corruption, pain, and groaning. We live in a body of death. We have the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lusts, Ephesians 4:22. We have the flesh that wars against the Spirit. We have the willing spirit, but we also have the weak flesh. We live in a body that is subject to weakness, tiredness, pain, sickness, sorrow, and death. It is like having a precious jewel in a clay pot. An earthen vessel is not valuable, not durable, little esteemed. It has many flaws. It is easily broken. It is heavy and earthbound. In contrast, the resurrection body will not be an earthen vessel. It will be characterized by incorruption, glory, and power. Now, Paul describes the believer's condition in the earthen vessel. The participles troubled, perplexed, persecuted, cast down are present tense, signifying a repeated action. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. Trouble is from the Greek word meaning to press together, compress, or afflict. It is translated narrow, afflicted, suffer. We have trouble, compression, pressure, affliction, and suffering. Note that we are troubled on every side. There is a lot of trouble. There are all sorts of troubles. There are troubles from many directions. Yet we are not distressed. This is from the Greek word, which means narrow, to crowd into a narrow space. So we are compressed, but we are not compressed. This means that though we experience pressures from trouble and suffering, we are not crushed by it. God allows us to be pressed in with troubles on every side, but he does not allow us to be crushed. With Paul, there was always this upward look. Paul may have been hard-pressed, but he wasn't boxed in. It goes on to say, we are perplexed, but not in despair. Now, perplexed in the Greek means not knowing how to proceed. Literally means to be without a way, to be without resources, embarrassed, in doubt. The believer is often perplexed by situations. He does not have the wisdom and resources in himself to deal with things, but he is not in despair. This is to be quite at a loss, without resource. The word perplexed translates the verb in the phrase meaning unto despair and translates a play on words. Paul is saying that the believer is perplexed, but not totally perplexed, not perplexed to despair because he has God's presence and promises. The believer is perplexed because of his weakness and trials, but he is not in despair because he has God's promises. He always has access to God's wisdom. There is a play on words here. Paul was at a loss indeed, but not a hopeless loss. Often doubtful which way to take, yet always finding some way open. We see this in the lives of the saints throughout Scripture. Moses in Midian, Joseph in bondage, Hannah's barren condition, David's fleeing from Saul, Jeremiah's persecutions, and Paul's forbidden to preach in Asia. Persecuted but not forsaken. Persecuted means to put in rapid motion, to pursue and to follow. It is translated persecute 31 times in the New Testament. Believers who determine to live godly are promised persecution. But though we are persecuted, we are not forsaken. God has given a double promise. I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Paul had great experience with persecution, but he was never forsaken by the Lord. Cast down but not destroyed. The believer is cast down by suffering, persecution, devilish attacks, besetting sins, but he is not destroyed. He cannot be destroyed, for he is in God's hand. Paul was stoned, beaten, imprisoned, slandered, rejected by his own churches, and otherwise cast down, but never destroyed. John Phillips observes, the word for cast down is in the Greek. It means to be smitten down or flung to the ground. Thrown over and over again to the ground is one way of putting it. Imprisoned at Jerusalem, imprisoned at Philippi, imprisoned at Caesarea, imprisoned at Rome, imprisoned at Rome again, Paul indeed knew what it was to be flung to the ground, but not destroyed. I may be knocked down and knocked down and knocked down again, but I am never knocked out. The word for destroyed is the same word translated lost in verse 3. Even though many a time it must have seemed like the enemy had a stranglehold on Paul. Nobody could knock Paul out. His enemies could mob him and malign him and mock him and maul him. They could even murder him, but even though they could not win, in the end, all they could do was martyr him. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus. Always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake. Christ promises people that they would suffer in this present world as he suffered, because they bear his name. If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love his own. But because you are not of the world, and I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said unto you, a servant is not greater than his Lord. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If you have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. But all these things they will do unto you for my name's sake, because they know not him that sent me. For even here you were called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow in his steps. 1 Peter 2:20. Paul called these troubles the fellowship of his sufferings, Philippians 3:10, and the afflictions of the gospel, 2 Timothy 1:8. We suffer for the sake of the kingdom of God. Paul exemplified being always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, in the most literal way, being stoned, beaten with rods and whips, imprisoned, shipwrecked, and in constant perils. Now Paul gives reasons why we have this treasure in earthen vessels. Why does God subject his redeemed children to such difficult situations? Why does he allow sin to remain and the devil to roam about and persecutions to abound so that the Christian life is one of constant warfare, both external and internal? Why does he commit the gospel to such frail creatures? Well, let's take a look at that. First, we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. An earthen vessel gets no glory, no matter what it contains. God does not save us for our glory, but for his own. By leaving us in earthen vessels and subjecting us to every type of suffering, yet upholding us in the suffering, in showing his power in the suffering and using us to preach the life-changing gospel, it is evident that the power is his and not ours. Whether or not unbelievers recognize it, the brethren recognize it and give God the glory. Religious men are themselves glorified for their self-righteousness and reformations and self-denials, but the born-again believer gives all glory to God. We may wonder why the Lord allowed his servant to go through such testings and trials. We would think that he could have served the Lord more efficiently if he had allowed his pathway to be free from troubles. But the scripture teaches the very opposite. God, in his marvelous wisdom, sees fit to allow his servants to be touched by sickness, sorrow, affliction, persecution, difficulties, and distresses. All are designed to break the earthen pitchers so that the light of the gospel might shine out more clearly. Second, we have this treasure in earthen vessels that the life of Jesus might be manifest in our body, that the life of Jesus might be manifest in our mortal flesh. The believer's suffering and weakness and inabilities manifest the resurrection life of Christ. We are 100% dependent upon him. The true Christian life is his life, not mine. Every progress and victory is his. I am kept aware of all this at all times by the fact that I live in an earthen vessel and have no spiritual power on my own, yet I am beset with difficulties and troubles. Third, we have this treasure in earthen vessels that we might benefit others. So then death worketh in us, but life in you. Paul repeats here what he said in chapter 1. For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also abounds by Christ. And whether we be afflicted, it is for your consolation and salvation, which is effectual in the enduring of the same sufferings which we also suffer. Here, the apostle sums up all that he has said by reminding the Corinthians that it was through his constant suffering that life came to them. In order for Paul ever to go to Corinth with the gospel, he had to suffer untold hardships. But it was all worth it, because they had trusted in the Lord and now had eternal life. Paul's physical suffering and loss meant spiritual gain to others. Robertson says, his dying was working out for the good of those who were benefited by his ministry, Believer's Bible Commentary. Fourth, we have this treasure in earthen vessels that we might live by faith. This is a major lesson. We are kept in a body of death. We are left with the old man, even though we have the new man. We are subject to trouble on every side, perplexity, persecution, casting down, and being delivered unto death, that we might live by faith and not by sight. Paul emphasized this in the companion passage in Romans 8. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man sees, why does he yet hope for? But if we hope for what we do not see, then we do it with patience. I believe, therefore I have spoken. The psalmist was in great trouble in Psalm 16, verse 10. The sorrows of death compass me, and the pains of hell hold upon me. I found trouble and sorrow. But he believed God's word and called upon the Lord, and God delivered him. Paul also believed God in his troubles. Because he believed, he spoke, he continued to preach, he continued to testify of Christ. Fifth, we have this treasure in earthen vessels that we might be in constant watchfulness for the rapture, knowing that he which raised the Lord Jesus up will also present us with you. The resurrection of the church age saints will occur at the rapture, and they are to live in expectation of it. Life in an earthen vessel keeps one in remembrance of his mortality and keeps one focused on the Lord's coming. Sixth, we have treasure in earthen vessels that we might depend on the renewal of the inward man. Though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. We are subject to trouble and lack and spiritual warfare so that we will focus on the inner man. In this mortal body, the outward man is dying, but the inner man is renewed by the Spirit of God. He restores my soul. Note that the renewal is day by day. We don't grow by leaps and bounds, but by steps. We don't achieve spiritual perfection by a second baptism. It is a process. We are changed into the same image from glory to glory, 2 Corinthians 3:18. We grow in grace. We add to virtue, faith and faith, knowledge, temperance, patience, godliness, brotherly kindness, and charity. It all has a process of spiritual growth. Seventh, we have this treasure in earthen vessels that the affliction might work for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. The unsaved have no promises of God. If they have hope in their afflictions, it is vain hope. But the saved are in God's hands, and we know that all things work together for the good to those who love God and to those who are called according to his purpose. Our afflictions and God's will have manifold purposes and benefits. They work out for us. They produce an exceeding eternal weight of glory. This looks ahead to eternity and to the manifestation of the sons of God when we will be glorified with Christ in his kingdom. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we also may be glorified together. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waits for the manifestation of the sons of God. Romans 8. An eternal weight of glory describes the unspeakable splendor and benefit of being a joint heir with the Son of God. Note that in comparison with the glory to come, our present afflictions are called light, but for a moment, we must see things through God's eyes that comes by filling our minds with God's word and meditating on it. And lastly, we have this treasure. We look not at the things which are seen, but the things which are not seen. To keep one's eyes on eternal things is the path of victory in the midst of suffering. The meditation of the heart is the chief battleground in the Christian life. What do we think about, dwell upon, and ponder and meditate on? This will determine the quality of our spiritual lives. If our minds are filled with the things of this world, we will be worldly. If our minds are filled with the things of God, we will be spiritual. Transformation of life requires renewal of the mind. We must meditate on God's word day and night and thus fill our minds with truth and righteousness and wisdom. We must set our affection on things above, not things on the earth, Colossians 3:2. We must cast down every imagination that is contrary to the knowledge of God. We can look at the things which are not seen by the word of God. We can see the invisible God, his character, his actions, his plans. We can see Christ. We can see the future. The unbelieving world has no such ability. All of this world's philosophers are groping in darkness.